these tick marks, and then at the end, I count them all up, and hopefully I hit my magic number of 23, which is how many pages I have from each Mouseguard issue to publish. If I haven't, I go back up and start reinvestigating. If I have a lot of tick marks next to one entry, I'll kind of look at that again and say, can I do that in 3 pages instead of 4? I think I can, and then I'll reassign. I'll adjust as needed. So then that's how I base this. When I go group by group, almost scene by scene, I'll do one or two pages at a time, doing the writing, the drawing, or actually the writing and drawing, but the drawing, like the penciling, the inking, and the coloring, and then I go back to this list and check out the next thing on the schedule is. And I do that until I get done. Like I said, for Black Axe, there are longer portions of text, so I'm writing out kind of full scripts. Some of it there's not a lot of like stage direction or description. I'm pretty much relying on either what's in my head or what's in my outline for that. This is purely for text, for the dialogue and text that's going to go into the comic. I've already made my line breaks, kind of figuring out what end of a line is a good place to end a page on as it fits with the outline. See, I've also made a couple. I've made a couple notes to change dialogue here, or maybe a couple scene notes. This one says, "Kelanon M's tuck in your stone basin, peering around it." I guess as I was kind of working, I thought that might be a good addition. Then, two pages. I work in a sketchbook where, instead of drawing each panel like as a page, I draw bits. I look at one of these pages and I say, what's the most important thing on that page? I need to draw that thing. So if it's a weasel standing up like here, then I draw that. Now I know that my panel has to be able to contain it. This is not going to be a horizontal panel. This is going to be a vertical panel. And I base the rest of the layout around that, drawing little bits. Maybe not even necessarily on the same page. Scan these, put them into Photoshop, resize everything so that it all fits in my panel borders with the text that I've now copied and pasted. And print them out full size, put them underneath a sheet of Bristol paper, Bristol board, on a light box, and then do the inks. That fast in the image drawing. If anybody is lost, I can pick you back up.
So you're not using the Bristol? I mean, you're not penciling on the
Bristol? I'm not penciling on the Bristol. Penciling in my sketchbook and then printing out a copy of that once it's been resized. I also do a lot of corrections that way because I find, especially with the mice, I tend to draw the heads too small. If I just draw it really quick, I draw the heads too small. So in Photoshop, I can take my cool drawing, there's nothing wrong with drawing, enlarge the head by 8.5% or whatever, and then the proportions look right. Or I might have a leg slightly out of proportion or in the wrong spot and realize, if I scoot that over this much more, it'll look like the weight's actually on that leg, so it's kind of floating. If I tried to draw everything together, I would have to draw all these characters in proportion in the setting, in perspective. And if I messed up and I start erasing, now I'm erasing background. So that's why I do the sketches that are all on separate layers and I can resize and adjust and fiddle before I get. That's kind of what I think of being my final pencils, even though they're printouts from the printer. Alright, ready, Bob? You guys, more questions?
So you do the characters and then you do the frame after the before and the after that?
The panel borders I lay out ahead of time on the computer. Like, I've already got a template for all the page dimensions and where the panel breaks would go. So I can kind of, in the computer, decide this is a two-panel page with a long horizontal panel on top, and this is kind of a big panel here. Then I'll start scanning pieces from my sketchbook and laying in characters here and there. Sometimes I'll also take photographs of the models that I build. You've never visited my blog. Go to my blog and search models. And you'll see I build a lot. I don't do any drawing in Photoshop. I'm a Luddite when it comes to that. My wife keeps trying to push me into to doing like a Cintiq or something. How cool it is and how everybody who has one says that it's cut their production time, you know, in half or something like that. But I still like the feel of pencil on paper. There are a couple times now and then where I'm doing like little, after I've done a drawing and I put it in Photoshop, and resizing won't fix the drawing. I need to actually get back in there. And that would be perfect if I had a Cintiq. Sketching something else in the sketchbook, scanning it, or basing it together.
What type of crystal board do you use?
Strathmore Smooth 300 series. It doesn't come with all these scribbles on it. And actually, what's cool is that Strathmore is the 300 series there. Strathmore came to me at a ChicagoCon a couple of years ago and just asked, they had their badge. They said, what kind of paper do you use? And I actually happened to be using the very paper they were pushing. I wasn't a blogger or anything. I said, what are you using? I said, Strathmore 300. And she showed me her name badge. And I said, oh, that's excellent. She asked if I'd want to endorse some comic papers that they were coming out with. I said, I'd be happy to do that. And then I said, on a side note, I do my books on 12 by 12 sheets. So I'm buying your 11 by 17s and then, or 14 by 17s and trimming them down. And I've got all this extra waste, plus it takes time for me to cut everything. Could you guys just quote trimming down some pads for me at 12 by 12 and ship it to me? Can you quote how much it would be per pad? And I said, we'll just make it part of our comics line. I said, but I'm the only guy doing 12 by 12, so that's a really bad addition to your comics line. Nobody draws comics that size. Well, you do. And then after that, a couple other publishers started doing 12 by 12s, and so now it's like a thing that you can get. You can get the very paper I helped on the market. Change the game. Yeah, I guess so. Well, let's get some drawing. Or do you want to leave questions or whatever? I don't want to bore you.
Let's try to watch you draw.
All right, let's have a talk. All right, what am I drawing?
You guys want to get drawing?
Saxon. Thank you. three-fingered thing was also a total mistake. I think it was from too many adolescent years of trying to draw Nightcrawler or the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And then somebody else pointed out, you know, mice have five fingers.
Really?
So, but it was too, again, I've drawn the head too small. Sometimes this is like the level of pencils that I would scan and then use as my basis to ink. When I'm inking, I'm concerned a lot with line weight and line texture. And this isn't going to be the best example. Things like these cross-hatching of the ears, if you think, I kind of learned it from doing woodblock printmaking, but the tighter I make these, the less white space there is between, and your eye will optically blend whatever's here to become some level of gray. The less white space and the tighter the black lines are together, the darker that gray is going to be until I fill it in all black. Way up to like 100% black. And the more space I leave between them, the lighter it's going to be. And I'll kind of show you that some of the stippling of the cloak. We're all varying a little more so you can kind of see what I'm talking about. I just realized I said I was going to give a sword. I like the idea of Saxon having gone through multiple swords, so I try to not ever show the exact same sword more than once. And there's a reference to it in the books where Kenzie says that Saxon Hunter is on. Shoot. This is a see-through sword. Now that Saxon in the Winter Woods has his former master's sword, I'm going to make him stick to that one. He's going to take better care of it. So with the stippling here, you know, I do this kind of even pattern, and it reads as, you know, just a little bit of shading. But the tighter I make it, I can make it so that it looks like it's really dark up here in the knot, and then just kind of gradually fades out. A harsher shadow here. Fewer dots that are scattered more apart, and then it actually looks like I rendered something in full gray if you hold it at a distance. I find a lot of artists who are doing any kind of cross-hatching or stippling tend to do a little bit more of a scribble pattern, and because I think of these as being both important for the black space but also the white space in between, and carefully controlling what that's going to look like in the gray, when you're scribbling, you're not being as conscientious of that, and I always feel like it shows. Of course, now it's really something to show you. In general, if you're an artist who's trying to do some stuff with line weights and texture, I would say try to avoid that scribbly thing, even though it kind of looks like you scribble those lines in. The distance between them and the weight of them have meaning. Some shading again. I'll start out, I'm going to fill that in totally black. And down along this bottom edge, and here along this bottom edge, I'll go a little lighter. But as I go further and further up, I'm going to tighten in, do more black, or maybe less white space. guys have questions while I'm doing this, go ahead and shut it down and try to answer.
Do you know the
I ink with, I used to ink with these, a Uniball Vision pen, which is an office pen, but I've since switched to these Copic multiliners as my normal inking choice. They're very much like a Micron pen with a felt nib. I had avoided using Microns in the past because with my stippling and then also just I'm a big clumsy monkey, I crush felt tip nibs to death, and I'd be buying a new pen every other line. But the Copic multiliners have a really durable nib, and they guaranteed their nib, so we figured we'd try it. And then also found out that they make one with a replaceable nib, so even if this big clumsy monkey destroys their indestructible nib, I can swap it out. So I've switched over to these Copic multiliners now. I get a little bit more variation in line width than I was with the Uniballs, so I like that. And I started with issue 3 of Black Axe using those exclusively, so hopefully we won't miss a difference. It'll just seem seamless, but slightly better. I guess all the pieces that I'm doing are going to be in the octo coming up.
Yeah, the auction that we're doing on Saturday night, which all of you should go to, bid high, bid often.
So there we go, we're Saxon.